If you remember last, the way we ended last class was I had this example of we increased Michael Scott's taxes. Well, we said that suppose he has his taxes increased by 10 bucks and he has a marginal propensity to consume of 75%. How does that tax affect his consumption? And so what we decided was that the tax of $10, propensity to consume means anytime he gets an extra $10, then he would see spend 75, save 25. So if he loses $10, that means he's going to lose out on 70% of spending and reduce saving by 25%. So that was the idea. Well, for every dollar of income, not really sure why I made the font so small, sorry. For every dollar of income, he spends 75%, saves 25%. For the $10 he loses, he would have spent $250 and saved, $750 and saved $250. So the tax multiplier right here. So let me go ahead. Like I said, we ran out of time last class, so I need to keep us moving as best I can. So tax multiplier. So now let's think about, instead of an increase in taxes, a tax cut. This is sort of easier to think about when we go over the tax cut. So same idea, $10 tax cut, marginal propensity to consume of 75%. So we start off, first thing that happens, if I cut your taxes 10 bucks, what we see is that's an extra $7.50 you spend. Save an extra $2.50, spend an extra $7.50. So we're gonna do this chart, remember where we show each round how much extra someone is spending, and then the total change in spending. So round one looks like this. So our initial cut of tax cut of 10, MPC is 75%. All right, so you got a tax cut and you went and bought a pizza. You spent $7.50 on this pizza. Well, whoever owns the pizza company now has an extra $7.50. They take that $7.50, save 25% of it, spend 75%. 75% of $7.50 is $5.63. And as we've done before, we take this and we can add up round two, 75% of this is round three, and so on. Keep doing this all the way until you get to round 100, at which point you're hardly, you're adding less than a fraction of a penny, and you see that the total change in spending is 30. So we started off with a $10 tax cut, wound up with a $30 change in cumulative spending. As you'd expect, we don't actually want to go through all these steps. We want to see if we could figure out a multiplier. And so what we are going to have next is the tax multiplier. Not going to make you figure out how we get there, but the tax multiplier is shown here. So tax multiplier equals negative marginal propensity to consume divided by 1 minus the marginal propensity to consume. Which in this case, negative 0.75 over 0.25, which brings us to negative 3. So based on this formula, which again, I'm not expecting you to derive, just write it down somewhere and you'll use it, write it down on a handy sheet of paper for use during the exam. And it comes out in this case to negative 3. So how do we use the multiplier? How does using the multiplier get us to this $30? Well, our change in GDP is going to be equal to the multiplier, which we just calculated at negative 3. So it's the multiplier times the change in our tax. So we had a tax cut of 10. Our multiplier is negative 3. Notice a tax cut means we had a the change in tax was negative 10. So our multiplier of negative 3 times our tax change of negative 10 gets us to an increase in GDP of 30. And negative 3 times negative 10 is 30. So our $3 decrease in taxes led to a $30 increase in GDP. And so the reason we did this, I did this here, is we said that there's really two levers for fiscal policy. One is we can change around government spending. Two is we can change around your taxes. And if you we briefly mentioned transfers as well. Just think of transfers as sort of negative taxes, so they sort of go in the same grouping of ways that we can adjust how much you're paying. Ways to adjust how much money you give to the government. All right, so we already talked about the government spending multiplier, how a small change in government spending leads to a big increase in GDP. Now we talked about the tax multiplier, showing how a small decrease in taxes leads to a big increase in GDP. Or a small decrease in taxes leads to a large increase in GDP. So just like how there is contractionary and expansionary monetary policy, we also have contractionary and expansionary fiscal policy. So first we'll look at expansionary fiscal policy. Like expansionary monetary policy, expansionary fiscal policy is intended to boost aggregate demand and boost GDP. So how do we do this? Some methods are, again, we have basically three methods. The first is we can increase government spending. That's one way of increasing aggregate demand. The others are we can decrease taxes or increase transfers. So remember, in decreasing your taxes, that means you mail less money to the government. Increasing government transfers would just be that money is not, the government is now mailing you money. So again, it's like a negative tax. And so the way these work, if you remember, we know that y equals c plus I plus g plus nx. So if we increase government spending, that's an increase in g. If we decrease your taxes or increase transfers, what does that do? That gives you more money to spend. So that's going to lead to an increase in c. Both of those lead to an increase in Y. So remember that Y is equal to GDP, which is also aggregate demand. So here is an example, like a real world example of expansionary fiscal policy. So the 2009 Recovery Act, this was following the housing market crash, Great Recession time. What happened was, so what were the actions taken? Well, there was an increase in government spending. The way that was done was through an increase in federal spending and an increase in aid to state governments. Those are both ways that we saw federal government and state governments spend more money. There's also a decrease in taxes, so most families received a tax cut. There was an increase in government transfers. That was done through increased unemployment benefits. So unemployment benefit, you lose your job, the government sends you a check. So that's a transfer. All right. So next we have contractionary fiscal policy. Like contractionary monetary policy, contractionary fiscal policy is intended to lower aggregate demand, which will lower GDP and reduce inflation. So methods there, are to go in the opposite direction. We can decrease government spending, increase taxes, and decrease transfers. So what examples do we have of that? Well, in 1968, there was some major inflation going on, and in order to combat inflation, there was an increase in taxes and an increase and an effort to reduce government spending. So this is going to go the other way with aggregate demand. So Y equals. So a decrease in government spending, we'll do that. If we increase your taxes, you're not going to go out to restaurants as often, so we decrease that. Both of those lead to a reduction in aggregate demand and a resulting reduction in GDP. So the next thing we're going to learn about is a term called automatic stabilizers. So what's an automatic stabilizer? That is a feature of existing government policy that automatically steadies the economy when applying expansionary fiscal policy, when the economy contracts, and applying contractionary policy when the economy grows. So you think of it as sort of like cruise control, where if you start heading up a hill and you need a little need a little more gas, cruise control automatically gives it a little gas. You are headed downhill, it'll take off the gas. And so the idea here is what we want. Automatic stabilizers are designed to keep the economy humming and keep it from expanding too quickly, keep us from having recessions. And government policies and laws often have automatic stabilizers built in. And this is good because we would prefer for it not to be the case that every time we have sort of some sort of dip in some increase in unemployment, you know, we start to maybe get close to entering a recession. We want it to be the case that certain policies automatically kick in to help the economy get out of it, rather than have to wait for Congress to come together, have to them agree there is a problem, have to get them to agree exactly how to solve it and pass a law. So automatic stabilizers for that reason are nice. So what are some examples? Well, one example is progressive taxation. So during a recession, incomes go down, so tax rates and tax revenues automatically go down, right? So you imagine if you were having to pay the same amount of tax when you lost your job as you do when you had a job, when you lose your job, you know, if you still had to keep paying these high taxes, you'd really have to cut back your spending a lot if you stopped, you know, stop getting an income, still have to pay taxes. So the fact that your tax payments go down a little is an automatic stabilizer. Next, we have government transfers. So during a recession, more people are out of work and collecting unemployment and Medicaid benefits. So automatically, when we go into recession, we start sending people more money just because that's the way that unemployment and Medicaid work. Next thing we're going to look at is an example on contractionary fiscal policy. It's on page 531 in the book. So the economy is initially in long-run equilibrium. Then there is a large increase in investment spending. How does this affect aggregate demand or aggregate supply? So again, aggregate demand shifts to the right. Why is that? Well, investment is a component of aggregate demand. So when investment increases, aggregate demand increases, which means it shifts to the right. All right. So to summarize, we have our initial equilibrium here. And then we have an increase in demand. Notice that when aggregate demand shifts to the right, what we have is GDP increases and the price level increases. Suppose the government does not intervene to stabilize the economy. What will eventually happen in the long run as a result of that shift? So, again, we want to, if the government doesn't intervene and we see GDP increase and the price level increase, what will that eventually do to wages? And how will that affect aggregate supply or aggregate demand? Good. So that is a tricky one. And to remind us, we've seen this before, but as a quick reminder of why it is that aggregate supply shifts in, the increase in aggregate demand increases the price level, which will eventually lead to an increase in wages. So two things happen. When GDP goes up, remember, this right here is long-run full employment. So in order for us to get above there, we have to have unemployment be especially low. So it's really hard to find a good worker if you're trying to hire. And prices go up. Things get more expensive. So now I go to my boss and I say, eventually, you know, when my annual review comes up and I can actually talk about my wage. And I'll say, you know, look, you don't have a lot of options for people to hire. Their unemployment's very low. I know you're selling our forklifts for more money, and everything I buy, all the groceries I buy are getting gotten more expensive. So for all of these reasons, I need a raise. Well, when my boss gives me a raise, that's going to lead aggregate supply to shift in. So aggregate supply was here. It's going to shift to the left. Why is that? Well, my employer has to pay me more. That works the same way as if their electricity costs had gone up. It's just an extra cost for the firm. Well, as we've said before, long-run GDP is determined by the capital and productivity of the economy, not the price level. So what that means is we have our aggregate demand shift to the right first, then aggregate supply eventually shifts to the left, meaning that we get back to our long-run aggregate equal, our long-run equilibrium. And what this is really saying is eventually the labor market's going to sort itself out. We're not going to have these people who are cyclically unemployed, and so, you know, people who are well-qualified for work and want to work. They're eventually going to find jobs. We're not going to have the example where the labor market's really tight and it's really hard to hire because basically unemployment is too low. Eventually, we think we're going to find our way back to long-run equilibrium. Notice that when we do this, the net effect is that we started off here. Follow the pink circle. We moved aggregate demand shifted out when investment increased. So our pink ball moved to that point. This is the one where price and GDP both increased. Then when input costs increase, here the main input cost being wages, aggregate supply shifts to the left. So our equilibrium point, the pink circle, is going to also move up and to the left. So real GDP returns to its long-run equilibrium value. And prices, notice, so GDP got bigger than Y star, now it's back to Y star. Prices are now above their initial equilibrium value, right? We started off here, prices have moved up to here. All right, so that's one option. And so maybe the government sort of thinks about this. So, you know what? We don't want to have this issue where demand increases, we have really high unemployment, we have a especially tight job market, and then we finally see the unemployment go back to the natural rate and our GDP go back to its long-run equilibrium, but we have this big increase in prices. We'd like to avoid that. Well, which of the following is a fiscal policy that the government could implement if it wants to return the economy to its initial long-run equilibrium GDP and prices? Great. So what's going on here? So why is it increasing taxes? Well, this is an example we talked about of contractionary fiscal policy. Remember, we're worried about inflation, so we implement contractionary fiscal policy. Taxes reduce disposable income, which reduces C, which reduces GDP, reduces aggregate demand. So one way we can think about it is here are the components of aggregate demand. And we know that when in the initial problem, we had this increase in I. And so what we'd like to do is hold aggregate demand the same. So we moved aggregate demand out because of the increase in investment. The way we move it back to the left is by decreasing some other component. And so by increasing taxes, taxes reduce disposable income, which reduces C. So now we have this decrease in C. Okay, so there's the idea. What this means is that if done correctly, obviously that's a big caveat, if done correctly, the tax increase will exactly counteract the increase in, investment and GDP. And GDP and prices will return to their initial long-run equilibrium. So again, if done correctly, the tax increase leading to the consumption decrease will exactly counteract the increase in investment. So now we can follow the pink circle again. We started off here. Increase in investment moves the whole curve to the right, which means the equilibrium moves to here. Now we increase taxes, which moves aggregate demand back to the left, gets us right back to where we started. Okay. Next thing we're going to look at is a problem from the book. This is the one, if you saw, I emailed it to you last night on the slides that we're gonna go through, just because it's not in the workbook. And I know some people I thought might wanna print it out so they could more easily follow along. So I'll tell you right now, this is a tricky question. It's using concepts we've learned, but we haven't seen this exact problem before. So again, it's a learning exercise. I don't expect you to know how to do it right now. So now let's suppose that we have a decrease in investment. And in fact, a decrease in investment shifted the aggregate demand curve to the left and triggered a recession. So we started off at aggregate demand here, shifts to the left, over to here. That triggers a recession, because notice what's happened. So we started off right here. It's point one. Notice in point one, we're in long run equilibrium. Aggregate demand equals aggregate supply equals long run aggregate supply. Move here to point two. So one thing that happened is GDP went down. Another thing that happened is the price level went down. So how much does aggregate demand need to increase to bring output to the full employment level? And like I said, this is a tricky one. One sort of thing to think about here is when we talk about aggregate demand increasing, what we're thinking about, how much does it need to shift to the right? So how much does aggregate demand need to shift to the right to get us back to full employment? Told you it was a tricky one. So the answer here is 10, and let's see why. So what we need to do is, getting back to what we did before, we said, remember before, aggregate demand shifted to the right, and what fiscal policy wanted to do was shift it back exactly to where it started. So what we want to think about here is, all right, aggregate demand shifted to the left, brought us into recession. Well, we need to move aggregate demand back to where it started. So now the question is, all right, how far did it shift? And when we look at how far it shifted, a shift is a shift means that we are holding price level constant. How much did aggregate demand go down? And so what we call this is that it's the horizontal distance between two lines. So what we want to think about then is, all right, what is the horizontal distance between these lines? Well, we want to take one point, hold price constant, and see how much it moves by. So here, holding price at 110, GDP would go from 15 to 5. Well, if aggregate demand only increases by 5 billion, then what happens then? Well, that takes us from this point being 5 to this point being 10.